Some of the games in the 2024 season that have good stakes, a lot of interest, but also close spreads. So I'm sorry, while Clemson and Georgia clearly is going to generate a lot of interest, the Bulldogs are 13.5-point favorites in that game. They do not make the cut. However, another matchup between ACC and SEC schools is, so in Charlotte, we're going to have Tennessee against NC State. Tom, we're not picking against any spread here. I just want to know, Tennessee and NC State playing at the beginning of the season, who you got?
Coin flips. I'm going to go with the quarterback I trust the most. It's early in the year, but it's got to be Nico.
ACC.
It's got to be Tennessee. Sorry, I got to go with Nico. He's the chosen one. He will be one of the best quarterbacks in the country. And also, I think that, I mean, we all know how I feel about Dave Dorn at NC State, but I just think right now, the couple of the guys Tennessee has up front on defense combined with Nico at QB, giving them the edge right now. I think NC State will be a force to be reckoned with in the ACC, but I don't think they get this game.
Excuse me. Sorry about that. I think you're probably right. I would love to take the other side. I think Dave Dorn could have a game plan, though, for Nico to kind of confuse him. This will be his first big game on the spotlight. Well, the other thing, too, that concerns me is Grayson McCall, outside of the Jamie Chadwell system, has not been as spectacular as he was within that system.
Sure.
So, you know, I'll be curious to see what, I mean, it is hard. I think we take for granted so many times players just hopping from one system to another. They're just going to be as good. There's always sort of a learning curve. Concerned about picking up the edge with potentially, I've seen some, you know, NFL draft mocks saying James Pierce could be one of the top picks in the NFL draft. So that, you know, he's somebody that could wreak havoc. But like, I think this is one of those games where the reason I think it's a good matchup for ACC versus SEC, NC State, I do think, is one of the more physical teams in the conference. Mm-hmm. So I don't think they'll struggle with the physicality of Tennessee. I think it's a really fun game.
Really, really fun game. There was some retention on the defensive side of the ball for NC State that will come in handy going up against Josh Heupel's offense and Nico Iamalieva. I do think it was interesting when we look back at last year, a step back undoubtedly from where that offense was humming with Hendon Hooker in 2022. How much of that is the quarterback that you had? How much of that also is the absence of two NFL wide receivers on the outside, you know, and just sort of trying to, you know, continue to maintain the level of production? I think that the two things that NC State did with their roster that are going to give themselves the best chance to be able to take down the Vols are retaining key defensive players, and then some of the pickups that they had from the transfer portal at wide receiver, a guy named Noah Rogers, who is, he's like ACC brand Jameson Williams. Noah Rogers couldn't get on the field at Ohio State, but he's still a really talented player. And since he's arrived in Raleigh, a lot of people are impressed and think that he can have a good season in that offense. I mean, we remember Casey Concepcion was like a really like flashy freshman at the beginning of the year. They got Jordan Waters from Duke, who's a good running back. I'm gonna go Wolfpack. I think that they can get it done. I'd be more concerned. I referenced this game earlier. I'd be more concerned about the trip to Cal. You know, I'd be more concerned about what happens when you get deeper into the year and you've got that mid-October road trip to Berkeley than necessarily what's going to happen in Charlotte, where you are going to have, I mean, Tennessee, NC State, they're going to pack that thing out. It's going to be a great, is the Duke's Mayo Kickoff Classic, by the way, week 2, one of the best games of week 2, Tennessee and NC State.
Will there be a Mayo bath for this one?
I
hope not. That's got to be safe for the bowl.
Okay, that's fair.
Keep the bowls unique and special.
Well, listen, you know you're going to get a lot of Mayo content, and Tubby will be there.
Thank God.
You know?
What's a football game without a
walking? I don't know. I don't know if NC State wins. Like, do you? I don't know if I envision Dave Dorn and embracing the Mayo bath. you know, he's going to be like, we are on to next week. And I'll hype him maybe the same. Like, it's
game. Carolina for that very reason. I will say, I don't know if I've ever mentioned this on the show, but like the Duke's Mayo Bowl, we talk about bowl sponsorships. We talked about sponsorships earlier in the show. Duke's Mayo may have been the most effective sponsor that I've ever had in sports, because when they sent like the care package before the first Duke's Mayo Bowl and it included Duke's mayonnaise, as a Chicagoan, we didn't really have Duke's Mayo up here. I'd never had it ever since. This has been a Duke's Mayo household. So that was an effective sponsorship.
Hey, listen, you got to have that twang. That's twang, zang. Shout out to the Charlotte Sports Foundation. And to your point about the Mayo bath, I don't know if you remember this, but NC State was actually in the Duke's Mayo Bowl against Maryland, and it is a game that I allege neither coach wanted to win. Mm-hmm. Final score, Maryland 16, NC State 12, and the decision-making from both Mike Locksley and Dave Doran in the final stages of this low-scoring rock fight sure suggested no one didn't want a Mayo bath. Now, credit to Locks, who then put on the super big hat for the Mayo bath, you know, the big hat. And so he at least went along with it a little bit, but I know we'll have Tubby. I know we'll have a lot of mayonnaise content. I don't think we'll have the Mayo bath, but if we do find that out, I'll be sure to pass along word. Okay. From that game to another one that I'm sure is going to get a lot of attention, because the Buffs are going to be on the road going to Lincoln. And Danny, I got to ask,
do you believe
in Colorado winning against Nebraska in the matchup of Deion Sanders' team against Matt Rhule's team, Dylan Rayola, Shador Sanders? It is going to be a centerpiece of the conversation that weekend.
What's the line at now?
Let's see.
Do you have it handy? Because I know it was, I think it was around a touchdown, but then was it 8? I think it's kind of fluctuated back and forth. I've seen a lot of odds coming back Colorado towards Colorado's favor. Like, they are getting more optimism around the program. I felt I could not have been more wrong. I remember last year, like, bet the house on TCU, laying 20. It's down to 5.
5.
I'm laying them all day long with Nebraska. Call me crazy. I just don't know how you can trust this team. And I know, and just a little preview, potentially, we're doing dark horses later. Maybe you'll hear this team come up again.
You said 6,500. I was like, oh,
I know. Dylan Rayola, it's first big game. There's way too much unknown at the surrounding supporting cast at Colorado. Too much turmoil towards the end of last season. Sea of red. Place is going to be rocking. I'm going Nebraska.
If I'm going with the same kind of philosophy I did with the last pick, I kind of have to go with Colorado. Like, it's early in the year for Dylan Rayola. He will be inexperienced. Shador has plenty of experience. The concern for me picking Colorado on the road against Nebraska will be their defense, because I do think Nebraska has far and away the best defense in this game, and I think that will pose problems. But for all I think of Shador's shortcomings, which he has some, I think one thing he was great at is he still didn't turn the ball over, and I think that plays well on the road in that environment if he's able to take care of the ball the same way he did last year, even if it means eating some sacks, which I'd like him to find a better balance between the two, but, you know, whatever. I'll go with Colorado here, just early in the season. If it's later in the season, I'm probably taking Nebraska.
That might be it is a principle with any team that you have depth concerns.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when do you play them? You're going to be playing them later. So I think home field is going to matter a ton, and not because boosters have been buying hundreds of tickets to keep the sellout streak going, but because I think that Nebraska is actually jazzed. Like, I think that they feel, and whether or not that will be, you know, replicated on the field is something that is going to be a fun storyline, because it's either going to hit, and the way we talk about Matt Rhule, the way that we talk about Nebraska, all those things could could really change from where they were in the last couple of years, or they'll fall short of expectations, and then the disappointment and the passion and everything else will be a big part of the conversation in the Big Ten. I think Nebraska and Memorial Stadium is going to be rocking for that game. And I see Tony White dialing up, just dialing up some big third down stops here.
Memorial Stadium has been sold out for a long time, and it has been rocking for a lot of home games. And Nebraska's 9-12 at home over the last 3 years. I don't know if the home field match is going to matter that much.
So you don't believe in the sellout streak's only been kept alive by mega boosters?
Oh, I 100% believe in that. I'm just saying it's always a very good and raucous environment. There are very few fan bases, I think, in the country as loyal and supportive as Nebraska football fans, because they are always there.
But they haven't had this much legit. They haven't.
Nebraska lose at home to some mediocre football teams the last few years, true. Chip. The crowd hasn't done a whole lot for them that matters more than what's on the field. Now, maybe again, I do think Nebraska is going to be better this year, but I don't think that home field advantage is going to matter much in this game.
We'll see. All right. And then the third one that we're going to do here is even though it's a non-conference game, it is in the Big Ten on CBS slot. This game will be at 3:30 p.m. Eastern time. It is the Cy Hawk Trophy, Iowa State at Iowa. And this one really is like true coin flip. Looking at it right now, about two, Iowa favored by about two. Tom, who you got?
Iowa. Without even thinking about it. And I wrote, we'll get more to it later. I've got Iowa State as one of my, kind of dark horsey teams. But if you just look at the history of this series, it's been a coin flip a lot of the time.
I thought Iowa State was a road team too, right? Don't road teams have a lot of success?
Maybe against the spread. But as far as winning the series, like Iowa, let me see if I could find it real quick. But Iowa kind of dominates this series.
Especially with Kirk Ferentz.
Yeah.
Like over the last 20, 25 years, it's been pretty lopsided. I am with Tom on this one. As much as I like Rocco Becht and what they've done at Iowa State, new offensive coordinator, depth, I think, comes into play. New offense for Iowa. I'm kind of excited to see what that looks like. I just think this is one of those ones where Iowa is the more physical team. Take the under, though. There's no doubt on the under, right? Whatever it is.
This game has a tendency to get like 55-52 in triple overtime. But looking at it overall, Iowa leads at 47-23. And like at the very start of the Ferentz era, like Iowa lost the first four under Ferentz. But since then, they have won like three to every one that Iowa State has won.
Iowa State won last year?
No, Iowa won last year.
Last year, 20-13. The year before, Iowa State went 10-7. That's the thing. When Iowa State wins, it's usually a stupid score. Like 9-6, 10-7. Yeah.
Something like they were just hanging around all game and then break it
44-41 in 2011.
Yeah, I'm there's a position that I'm not all the way in on, but that Iowa State was so thrown off by the gambling scandal at the beginning of last year that you might want to give a little bit of a boost to the way you're thinking about them now that all of that has passed. That you would maybe look at early season results especially and just start to imagine not just the absence of players, but the fact that it was ongoing, the investigation and everything else. Just something that I'm at least considering as we're starting to run through all the different analysis of this. But that said, give me Iowa.
Another angle worth considering, though, Iowa's got a brand new offense, right? They're playing Illinois State to open the season. We're probably not going to see a whole hell of a lot of what they plan to do. This will be the first game I think we actually see Iowa's offense, so it's going to make it more difficult for the Cyclones to prepare for it because they're not going to be sure what's coming.
Yep. Also, remember, don't take any expectations based on the result of this game for how either team will fare in conference play. Mm-mm. It exists in a universe unto itself.
This is like a separate season.
Yeah, and we get to peer in on this special universe on CBS. We're very fired up about it.